even though we've been in Roswell since 1973. And that tells me we've got a lot of work to do to let our community know that we're here and we're part of Roswell, very proud and have been for some time. In fact, your mayor, his mother was our first kindergarten teacher. So we've been very happy to have a long history with the city of Roswell. And it's our pleasure to host the candidate forum for the second time in the past 2 years. We also offer lots of free community programs that you can find out about through our Facebook page, as well as probably postings at different Starbucks around town. We have a speaker series in which we bring in nationally known speakers, November 17th, 2 weeks from Tuesday. This will have hundreds of people in here to come see a speaker named Kevin Carroll, who will talk about the importance of play in our daily lives. We often forget that play is something we all still need to do. It's very important. On November 12th, backing up, we also have a private high school admission fair. So if any of you have kids or know people who are looking into private high schools, we'll have all of the ones in the Atlanta area, including some boarding schools right here at High Meadows, all free. We are a preschool through eighth grade school with 400 kids, about half of whom live in the city of Roswell. And we are we're quite unusual in lots of great ways that are fitting for who we are today as a nation and in the world. We are an international baccalaureate world school, which means that we are in concert with schools all over the world and focusing on global concepts and ways of looking at education that are more about asking questions than getting answers told to us. Our kids, as you might have seen before the sun went down, spend a good amount of time outdoors. We feel very strongly about the importance of playing and being outdoors and having fresh air. Our kids are outside for at least an hour a day. And on this 42-acre campus, it's a real gift to be able to give to our kids. They also achieve. About two-thirds of them go to local public schools. The most go to Roswell High School and other local public schools in East Cobb and North Fulton. And then about a third go off to independent schools in Atlanta like Pace and Galloway and Westminster. Our kids are well prepared to do great things. I see a couple of alumni parents who can attest to that, whose child has achieved very great things at Centennial High School. So if you are a parent of a child between the ages of 3 and 14, and you're looking for an education that really is about preparing students for the world and the challenges that come to us in the world, consider High Meadows. Come back up here and visit us, because we will be here for many, many more years. And proud to be a part of the Roswell community. Thanks.
Okay, so next up, we're going to have Mayor Jerry Wood come on up and give us a quick, just high level, setting the stage for what we're looking at for the next couple years here in Roswell, and maybe some other comments. If you know Mr. Mayor, he does go a little bit ad lib on us every once in a while. So, welcome, Mayor.
Thank you. It's appropriate at Roswell Next to talk about what we can expect next in the city of Roswell. Well, the truth is, I'm not sure what's next in the city of Roswell, because a lot depends upon the decisions of the council members that you elect tonight. So it is an important decision. I know you'll be listening closely to make the right decision. I do know this, the biggest issue facing the city of Roswell, the biggest thing that's driving things in the city of Roswell is the growth in population in metro Atlanta. Not Roswell's population, but the growth in population around us. The Atlanta Regional Commission is projecting the population will grow from 5 to 8 million people over the next 25 years. And so whether or not we make any issue one more building permit in the city of Roswell, we're going to see a lot of growth around the city of Roswell, which means we're going to see a lot of increase in traffic, whether we want it or not. So I think one of the things that this council needs to worry about next is what do we do to try to manage what's coming our way? And I see two basic ways that we've got to deal with this increase in population, whether it's in Roswell or outside of Roswell. and the traffic that is going to put on our streets, whether we issue any more permits. First, you can look at zoning. And we can influence where and what allows us to develop in this town. But we are limited by the market and by the constitutional rights of those property owners. I think two of the biggest issues that this campaign is focused on when it comes to land use and zoning, not any particular projects, was the question about traffic. Do we wait until we solve the traffic problem until we address redevelopment? Before we allow any more development to occur? I will tell you my concern is, I don't think we're ever gonna solve the traffic problem as long as Atlanta is continuing to grow, because Atlanta will, our streets will be continuing to be addressing. So what do we do about development and what's the relationship with traffic? Another issue that I see is the issue of residential density. It's been a big issue in this campaign. And there's also a movement to try to get more affordable housing for seniors and more affordable housing for the workforce. Problem being is without increased residential density, I'm not sure we're going to see more affordable housing. So that's another issue that this council and y'all are going to have to address is, are we going to allow greater density in some parts of Roswell to accommodate affordable housing and workforce housing for seniors? Issue for this council to discuss. The other big tool to deal with the growth that we're facing is how do we make our capital expenditures. Traffic. Everybody up here knows it's the biggest issue facing the city of Roswell. So we can spend money to address those traffic problems. So some of the projects we're looking at is $50 million for the Big Creek Parkway. That's a new road over 400 to connect East and West Roswell. There's $20 million if we improve South Atlanta Street and eliminate that suicide lane, that reversible lane. There's a lot of interest in sidewalks, in increasing sidewalks in the city of Roswell. We can spend millions of dollars on that. The council is looking at a city green. It's estimated that this would be a green in front of City Hall. Estimated cost $5 to $7 million. There's an interest in a trail and preservation of green space on a 50-acre tract between Martin's Landing and Holcomb Bridge Road. There's about a $5 million price tag if that entire parcel is purchased. We're interested in putting a parking deck near Canton Street. We don't have a parcel yet. We don't have the true estimate, but it's in the ballpark of about a $5 million project. So all of these projects are needed to address the issues of growth and traffic in the city of Roswell. And the tough part is not do we support those projects, but how do we pay for them? Here's where we are right now. We have about $4 to $5 million a year if we pay as we go for projects. We could borrow an additional $25 million. Well, it will be up to these gentlemen, or three of them, to make a decision on how we spend that money, and I think we need to spend that money to, ladies and gentlemen, I apologize. Two ladies, I apologize. So that's a question for these people. What's next? They've got to make a decision on where these capital expenditures are made. But I want to close by saying I am confident that every one of these candidates wants Roswell to remain a great place to live. That's why they're running. And I'm confident that everyone here is going to be listening to their answers and will make a good decision. And if you make the right decision and they make the right decision, Roswell is going to become an even better place to live, because in the 66 years I've lived here, I will tell you it gets better every year. And I'm confident that we're going to get better every year with your help and with their help. So I've got two requests today. I know everyone here has either voted or is going to vote, because if you weren't a serious voter, you wouldn't be here tonight. But I know you all have neighbors who have probably not paid much attention to this campaign, so I want you to get them out to vote. And the second request is I want you to stay involved in the city of Roswell, whether you're a candidate or a citizen here tonight, because the council, whoever that may be, And I need to hear from you more than once every 2 years when there's an election. Because our job is to represent you, and we need to hear from you. So thank you for coming tonight. I know that you care about Roswell, and that you want it to be a great place to live and remain that way, because you came here tonight. Give yourselves a hand. Thank you so much, and thank you, Nick.
So next up, we're going to get into candidate introductions in just one moment. Each candidate's going to have 1 minute to introduce themselves. But before that, I want to make sure that the audience here understands the rules of tonight's forum. It's a little bit different than maybe any forums that you've been to before. The way this is going to work, obviously up front, candidates will introduce themselves. They have 1 minute. The next thing is three rounds of question-answer. Okay, so in each round, each candidate will get one unique question. So the question will go, Rich, well, not in this particular order, but Rich will get a question, Mike will get a question, Becky will get a question, so on and so on, through the order that we drew ahead of tonight. So once they're done with their questions, and they'll have 1 minute, 30 seconds to answer and address each of those questions, then there will be a candidate's choice period at the end of that round, where they have another 60 seconds to either elaborate on their prior question, address something that was said further down the line or on another question, and or just fully take on another question if they are so interested that they decide they really like that other question that they didn't get. So that's a one complete round, and then we'll go into round two, round three, and once we're done with round three, there will be closing remarks. Each candidate will have 2 minutes to give their closing remarks. So that's the way tonight's going to work. Sorry about that. So that's the way tonight's going to work, and we should get out of here by about 9 o'clock, the way we've timed things. So before we get into candidate introductions, though, I do want to thank a few folks for coming tonight, and I see in the crowd we have several of our current city councils, and I apologize if I didn't see you before we started tonight, but I know we have Mr. Jerry Orleans there. So Mr. Orleans, thank you for coming tonight. Am I missing any other council members? I apologize. I know, we're getting there. We also have our judge, Brian Hansford, who's also on the ticket but running uncontested, so thank you for coming tonight. And we have one of our representatives down in Atlanta in the Gold Dome, Ms. Betty Price. Thanks for coming. Okay, so introductions are just going to go straight down the line alphabetically by post. Post one, tonight we have Rich DiPolito. So Rich, I'll give you the microphone. You have 60 seconds to introduce yourself. Thank you for having me.
Thank you, Mike, and thanks to all of you for being here this evening. And I appreciate Roswell Next and High Meadows School for putting this forum on. It's really fabulous to be here this evening. I want to thank my beautiful wife, Kelly, my daughters, Caitlin and Kristen, whose love and support enabled me to serve each of you. A little bit of background on me. I have a degree in architecture from the University of Virginia. I also have an MBA from the University of Georgia. And I've worked the last 25 years in real estate and in architecture. Kelly and I moved to Roswell about 14 years ago. And we moved here for a lot of the same reasons that you all probably moved here as well. We like the beautiful neighborhoods, the really incredible schools, and the wonderful recreation and parks program that we have here. That all adds up to our wonderful quality of life. That's one of the things that I talk to residents all the time about, that they love Roswell because of the quality of life. And I have seen it as my mission to make sure that we protect and enhance that quality of life. And that's what I plan to do for the next 4 years. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everybody that's here today. Just really appreciate the opportunity to get to introduce myself to all of you and for us to discuss a lot of current issues going on in Roswell. So something you should know about me is I've spent really a lot of my focus and really all of my time really growing in financial services and doing well on the corporate level. And then I really spent a lot of my time and effort all within my MBA at Emory. And then a little over a year ago, I was blessed with getting to have my daughter, Vienna, where my wife and I are very proud. That's where my wife is right now. And as I see Vienna growing up, I'm so focused on wanting to make sure that Roswell truly remains the greatest place to grow up and to live. So I've been so focused on what's going on in Roswell, and I realize that City Council has so much effect on really where our town is going to go. And with that, so when we discuss tonight, you'll see really how I want to work hard to make sure that Roswell continues to be the best place for any child to grow up and for all of us to get to live.
They're staying away from me. Good evening, and thank you, Roswell Next. And I'm not an orator, I do have to read, sorry. Just to let you know that I have served the interests of Roswell and Fulton County citizens for 20 years. I started as a community advocate, and then I moved later on to work for Commissioner Mike Hinn and Commissioner Bob Fulton. And after leaving Fulton County, I served on the Roswell's Design Review Board, as well as various city, county, and state committees and advisory groups. My experience and leadership mean the citizens can expect continued effectiveness for our city while retaining a AAA bond rating and balancing the budget without raising your millage rate. My focus on controlled and responsible revitalization and redevelopment is bringing in new businesses, increasing revenue while enhancing our quality of life. Working consistently on behalf of taxpayers, I've established many relationships with local and state government officials that have proven invaluable during my first two terms on Roswell City Council, and I thank you so much.
Shane Gray. Shane, thank you.
Hey everybody, my name is Shane Gray, and obviously I'm running for City Council Post 3. I'd like to thank everybody for being here tonight, and I would like to thank my beautiful wife, Amanda. She's right over there. I know. I'm going to emulate the mayor in two things. Number one, I am also going to ask you for two things. Number one, if you haven't already cast your ballot, have an open mind. That's all I can ask. Allow me to potentially persuade you. The second thing is please save me a chocolate chip cookie. I have not eaten since lunch and I'm starving. So other than that, I started working in Roswell about 20 years ago at Pope Chevrolet on Alpharetta Highway. I'm an eighth generation Roswellian, if that's a word, I think it is. My grandmother was a Coleman. I have all of my family here. My grandfather built the house that my father was born in front of Barrington Hall. I'm going to tell you why I'm uniquely qualified this evening. Just listen. Thank you.
Thank you. And thank you, Roswell Next, for hosting this forum. Basically, what I want to tell you is I want to serve my city. Dion and I have been here since 1986. We've raised our family here, and my grandkids are here now as well. And with a bachelor's degree and a master's degree from the University of Michigan and over 30 years of experience in financial services, I am well qualified for this position. As manager of an 11-state region, I have personal responsibility for over $160 million in assets, and I manage all of the advisors in that territory. I'm skilled in research, strategic planning and analysis, and I understand zoning and economic development. I can help Roswell achieve robust and smart growth. I bring private sector experience to the City Council, but I also have dealt with City Hall through a decade of volunteer service. I'm a member of the Roswell Initiative for Community Housing, and that was recognized by the mayor this week for our work on housing and neighborhood revitalization. As president of a large HOA, I took them from a financial instability to a long-term surplus. I've helped neighborhoods and developers create good projects around the Coleman Road that have the support of the people. And I look forward to helping Roswell grow and prosper. Thank you.
How's everyone doing? In 1872, Susan B. Anthony was fined $100 for casting an illegal vote, an illegal ballot. Infuriated at the injustice, she embarked on a speaking tour in support of female voting rights and changed the world for me and many others. Hello, everyone. I'm Kay Howell. And I believe that voting is a privilege and a right. I also believe it's a privilege to live in Roswell, Georgia. Today, you will meet many candidates aspiring for your vote, as you've heard and you will hear. According to some people, we all pretty much say the same things. What you think we want to hear. And you're here to see if you like anything that we say. And what I've discovered is, none of us are really listening to each other. So it appears that we have lost hope in the process, especially voting locally. But if we all lose hope and faith in each other and this process, then the past influencers, Susan B. Anthony and the others, will have been in vain. Tonight, I want you to not only listen to my words, but to look into my eyes and understand that I believe in this process. My name is Kay Howell. I'm the candidate that will listen to you, learn from you, and lead with you. Thank you.
My name is Nate Porter. I'm running for Post 3. For those of you guys that don't know anything about me whatsoever, I'll show a little bit. I'm a millennial. I'm a small business owner. I have a wife. I have two kids. I have three dogs. My wife and I, our businesses are here in Roswell. The other cool thing about being a small business owner is I started originally at a young age. I did really well in Grand Rapids, Michigan, and I lost my business. So I've also failed at business. And then it was when I moved back down here, or when I moved down here originally, that I was able to build my business up again. And now my wife and I, we're doing well. We're the exception, though, I would say, to most millennials. We're not the normal. And I will say this, I'm the exception to all of the candidates up here, and I can promise you that. And I'm the exception in the sense that everybody else here is the same brand, just a different degree. They're all fine with the vanity projects. They're all excited about spending more money on vanity projects. I'm the only person that's running that wants to put the vanity projects on hold and actually wants to deal with the problems, the transportation issues that exist here in Roswell, and that will become very apparent to everybody tonight. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ricky Spencer. I'm a 60-year resident of the city of Roswell. I've been here my entire life. First, I'd like to thank Roswell Next. You guys do a great job. For the past 39 years of my life, my motto has been conserve and protect, and that's what I've done as a firefighter and as the fire chief for 10 years here in Roswell. That was a great milestone for me when I made fire chief, because I aspired to do that when I was in my 20s. My professional career has been in the fire service and emergency medical field, and I feel blessed to be able to have done that here in Roswell for you guys. My big thing is quality of life, just as Mr. Dipolito. I think that we have a great quality of life here in Roswell. People before us have made it. I want to keep it and even make it better in the future. I appreciate your vote on November 3rd. Thank you.
Thank you very much, everybody, and we appreciate those introductions and the background. All right, so I want to give introduction to our moderator tonight, Aaron Gravett. Aaron is a Roswell resident of 8 years. He and his wife Laura live here along with their two children. Aaron has held roles within corporations within the real estate and IT sectors. His wife is also a small business owner here in Roswell. Both Aaron and Laura have been actively involved in various Roswell boards and communities over the past few years. Aaron's presently a board member for the Roswell Housing Authority, the Roswell Arts Commission and Fund, and he was a former founding board member of Roswell Next. Please join me in welcoming Aaron Gravett.
Welcome. Mike, thank you very much for that warm welcome. Can you all hear me?
I think you have to hold it close.
Is that better?
Yeah.
Okay. Mike, thank you very much for the warm welcome and introduction. I appreciate it. Well, you've heard tonight from the candidates so far. They've introduced themselves, well, as they say in boxing, let's get it on. Question one.
graduation high school.
For Ms. Howell. Topic, citizen involvement. A common citizen complaint is that the city government is complicated and inaccessible to the average person. City meetings are tough to attend and often seen as meetings that are held behind closed doors. Zoning codes are seen as difficult to understand. City staff and elected officials are seen as sometimes rude or even callous. Here's the question. What specifically would you change in this area to improve the city's image in this critical area?
So, can you hear me?
Thank you. So, you've probably heard that I'm a process improvement consultant, and I would just put that skill to work. And this is about, I would say it was about organizational change. So having the community involved in city government is important, and here's what I would do. First of all, we should involve the community by advertising that we want you to come out and participate. That's number one. Number two, when we get there, we should be welcoming. And some of the rules that may have been discussed recently, we might want to pull back on that and have more of an inviting tone to the city council meetings. I think those are the two main important issues as far as what I've seen recently is that, like, for instance, in our last meeting, Ricky was there as well, there was some consideration regarding the rules of having people interact with the city council. And I felt that that was a roadblock to have our community involved. I think that it is best to make sure we have an open policy and people can say what they feel and be respectful with that. And I think that pretty much covers it for me.
Okay, thank you very much. Question two is to Mr. Palermo. Topic, MARTA. MARTA's Connect 400 plan is part of a larger $800 billion plan to expand the system. The preferred alternative for Connect 400 is heavy rail up the 400 corridor to Windward Parkway. Heavy rail would be an extension of the existing red line from North Spring towards Spring Station. Heavy rail were to expand up Georgia 400, Fulcrum Bridge would be a stop. Here's the question. Are you in favor of a heavy rail expansion into North Fulton? Why or why not? Preference aside, what economic impact would it have on Roswell?
That's a great question. And this is an example where I feel that we really need more involvement and direction from the residents. Because when we have six city council members, we have one mayor, and really when there's such a big impact, I think that's where we really need to be getting more resident direction and seeing what do the people of Roswell want. So I want to preface this question by answering really, I feel the right approach if I'm fortunate enough to be an elected city council member, is to make sure to really get the direction, really get the feel from the people of Roswell. That being said, to not skirt and hide from your question, I will state that and get into from an economic impact standpoint, I have seen in lots of parts of the country with similar demographics, et cetera, of Atlanta, I've seen a lot of resistance to the public transportation, but then when it's actually gone through, I've seen a lot of situations where it actually did increase values, both home values, as well as the fact that reducing traffic. So I think there are a lot of advantages to bringing heavy rail to North Fulton. I think it's something we really should look at closely, but it's something where we should be including the people of Roswell to decide ultimately how they feel about the many advantages, as well as the disadvantages associated.
Thank you. I would like to pause before we continue. How's the audio before we go on? Okay. A little bit more? Okay. Yeah, before we get to the next question, thank you. How's this? A little bit better? Okay, thank you all very much. Okay, question three to Mr. Gray. Topic, parking. Canton Street District has created a vibrant place for the greater Roswell area and beyond. All right. Let me start over. Canton Street District has created a vibrant place for the greater Roswell area and beyond. However, those driving in and around the surrounding area and neighborhoods struggle to find parking. Here's the question.
How would you create a parking plan that helps create more opportunity for development in this walkable area, but still serve a vehicle-driven society?
Well, I will say this. I knew this was coming up. This is a huge issue, especially for the people that visit Camp Street. I feel like I'm screaming. Am I screaming? Okay. I'll hold it like this. Okay, I'm getting a thumbs up in the back. So, when we look at parking on Camp Street, we spend a lot of time down there. It should be easy to get into and out of. And I don't know if spending $3 is the right answer every single time you want to go and visit a gallery on Camp Street. So I absolutely think that a parking garage is necessary. Where is it going to be located? That is the question. How much is the cost? Like I've said before, I'm in the car business, and these are things parking is uniquely, is not unique to the car business, but we deal with this on a daily basis. This is something where we have constraint. And when we have constraint, there's no more real estate, there's only one option, and that option, unfortunately, is to go up. It's not the most indicative of our character of downtown Roswell. So what I'm challenging, if I am elected, I'm going to challenge the rest of the council to not just look at going up, but going down. I think subterranean parking is absolutely an option for us. Once again, the plots in the land, that's going to be the question. Where can we house it? But with the topography of downtown Roswell, I absolutely think that we can make that happen. Thank you.
Next question is to Mr. Wood. Topic is diversity. Our community is far more diverse than many would believe. We see ourselves as traditional family communities, yet only 35% of the households have children under the age of 18. Over one-third of our community is comprised of minorities, Hispanic, African-American, and Asian, to name a few. We are growing older as a Roswell population, with the number of residents over 65 increasing 10% in 2012 to 16% in 2030. An estimated 9% of the households live below the poverty threshold as of 2013. Here's the question. Demonstrate your understanding of the residents' makeup of our city and speak to how you will serve to improve the quality of life within each constituency group.
Actually, there are two parts to that question, or two parts of the answers to that question. First of all, in terms of the Hispanic and Latin community, they represent about 14%. All minorities represent 22%, and 78% are white. The growth in minority population has been growing over recent years, but also our growth in the aging population is rather significant. And that aging population finds that there's not enough affordable housing for them, especially if they're in a house that they've lived in for 30 years, it's on a large piece of property, and it might be worth now $250,000 to $300,000. If they want to downsize to a smaller home, they can't do that in Roswell because the average price of a house in Roswell is over $300,000. And the new developments that are being considered are starting with cottages of $400,000. Well, if somebody's trying to downsize from a house that's $250,000 to $300,000, going to $400,000 is going to be difficult for them to pay for it. So there are a couple of different issues here. One is the need for additional housing that people can afford to live in. So for seniors, and by the way, there are only 7 assisted living communities in Roswell. And so that's another area that needs to be looked at more carefully. But we need to find ways, and about the only way to do that is to increase density. But where is the best place to increase density? The best place to increase density is near city center.
You're out of time. Thank you. Next question is to Mr. Spencer. Topic, art. The city is moving towards creating a strong public art policy and organization. Question, what specific actions will you advocate to strengthen this particular strategy? And why you support strategically strengthening the arts in Roswell? Please be specific.
The arts has never really been to Roswell. I am glad that attended a meeting at Oak Street a couple, 3 weeks ago where we were versed on the arts and how they can make our city more attractive to people to come and watch and look and spend their money here and especially view the arts. It's funny how I get this question because one of the first arts that's going to be initiated in Ross will be in the new fire station that is going to be station number 4 on Holcomb Bridge Road, excuse me, Old Alabama Market Boulevard. I think that the fire station will welcome the arts. I like the idea of the arts. I think that it's way past time that we had arts in Roswell. And I like the way the city's going about putting the arts into new construction. So the final word on that is I like the arts. I think you'll like the arts when they get here and they start bringing in artists from all parts of the country to make it this place a showplace for the arts. Thank you.
Thank you. Next question, question 6, Mr. DiPolito. Topic, Roswell City Walk. The new Roswell City Walk apartments are currently over 80% leased and should be fully leased in the near future. Resident makeup is 55% age 37 or younger. 45% of the residents work within 10 miles, and another 25% are between 10 to 15 miles from their workplace. This suggests that City Walk has attracted a millennial and young Gen X clientele who primarily work in North Fulton. Here's the question. Do you support this type of development in our city? Why or why not?
Thank you.
There we go, sorry. Thank you. Roswell City Walk was a really unique project for us, and that's because originally the land was an apartment complex that we had a lot of severe issues with. There was a lot of crime, continual problems with maintenance, and it really was not a good place for the residents to live. So that was a great opportunity for the city to work with the landowner to come up with a project that could really have a positive impact on the community. When I first was on council, one of the questions everybody asked me, other than what are you going to do about transportation, is what are we going to do about that apartment complex? The Fraser Street apartments are just awful. One of the things that we did was we put together a new development code, and I know there's been a lot of discussion about that, but one of the positive outcomes of that is that it enabled the redevelopment of the Fraser Street apartments into what is there today. And I think it's a real positive impact on the community. It's a good development from the success of it. And I think as we see it continue, we'll start to see more walkability, and those residents will really start to integrate into the community. So it's a real positive. And did I answer your question? I think I might have gone off on a tangent.
You did.
All right, thank you.
Next question is to Mr. Porter. Topic, economic development. The strategic economic development plan dated April 2012 is almost 4 years old now. I'm reading from the plan now. Operational goals were to increase the awareness, understanding, and support of the economic development within Roswell, to establish the city as a partner in economic development, and to enhance Roswell's economic and fiscal health within context of the North Fulton County market. It also had implementation goals to promote the retention and expansion of existing Roswell businesses, to cultivate the entrepreneurial spirit of Roswell residents, and to foster a market climate attractive to a variety of businesses, sizes, and interests. Here's the question. Do you feel that we have had a successful implementation of the plan? Why or why not?
Personally, I think as far as, if you want to measure it by having hit some of the goals or having accomplished some of what was promoted, yeah, sure, it was a success, but at what cost was it a success? The way this plan works, essentially, if we talk like GM gets a little incentive to come here. They move a bunch of jobs. Really, they're, you know, executive type jobs. So it's really people moving from other places that come here. Yeah, there's some new jobs that pop up, but they take local business. Sorry, Ricky. They take local business money, from residents. Some of it comes from the state, but I pay state income tax. Some of it comes from the federal government, but just like all of you, I pay federal income tax too. So either way you look at it, it's money that's coming from us. And it's then given to an already rich company like GM so that they can move jobs here. Well, what a lot of these companies do, just so you guys know, is they follow these little subsidies all around from city to city. So they'll come to this city for 5 years, go to another city for 5 years. And all they're doing is they're pillaging these subsidies. So it's all these little booms of growth. So sure, I'm sure we hit some of the objectives. I'm sure there's some positives from it. But the reality is that that's short term. We're attracting somebody with a little, flashy coin to get them to come here. But my business that's been in Roswell and wants to stay in Roswell, we don't get any of that incentives. I just have to pay the taxes for these other businesses to come in. I'm sorry, I gotta stop doing that. So again, it just depends on how you want to measure it as to whether it's not a success. Did we hit some of the goals? Sure.
Mr.
But was it the right way to do it?
You were.
Sorry, thank you.
Last question in this round before we get to the candidate's choice. Ms. Becky Nguyen. Topic is traffic. The lack of connectivity in Roswell is crippling our arterial and highways. Small trips from one subdivision to another often require a drive from one arterial road, which causes unnecessary traffic on major roads. This lack of connectivity has resulted in significant vehicular congestion. Here's the question. Would you support a text amendment to the UDC that would require new developments to have at least 2 ingress/egress points when possible? Why or why not?
That's very interesting. I'm sorry that it's kind of out. That was actually one of our agenda items at our committee yesterday. And I've always felt that that we should have 2 egresses and ingresses, not for just emergency services, but I think also to help alleviate the traffic. And I think that's what we did with, if you look at Vickery, the transportation department had put in that there had to be an entrance to Thomas Place and plus Woodstock to help with the disbursement of traffic. So yes, I do. I feel that that's how we can get our walkability, our connectivity, and hopefully if some of our neighbors would like to do maybe some trails to connect subdivisions either by PTVs or personal transportation vehicles or by walking, but I definitely do support 2 egresses and ingresses in our new subdivisions.
Thank you. You have about 30 more seconds. Would you care to elaborate? Give you that opportunity.
I just want to let you know that usually people tell me I talk too much, so I'm trying to really keep it in.
Well, we appreciate that. Thank you so much. Okay, now we're moving on to, we're still within round one, but going to candidate's choice. We start again with Ms. Kay Howell. Okay, are there any comments that you would like to readdress?
Yes.
So I mentioned 2 terms earlier, process improvement and organizational change. And I want to explain that really quickly. So I said it like you already knew what it was. Process improvement is the ability to go into organizations and companies and figure out in their process what might be broken. And I go in and make that more efficient. So that's what I meant as far as process improvement. The organizational change term that I mentioned, around that effort of involving the community, what we would need to is to create campaigns, newspapers, however, to get the word out to the community that we are interested in what you have to say and you're valued. So those are the 2 terms I needed you to understand. I didn't want to overlook that. Thanks.
Thank you. Next up is Mr. Palermo.
Excellent, thank you. So I want to address the first question that was brought up today. It was something along the lines of what would you do to change the image of city government? I think this is very important, and I really feel that we need to bring transparency and accountability And the way that I would actually propose doing that is during this campaign, I've found that a lot of residents aren't aware of how their council members had voted. So I have brought up in the past that many council members weren't aware how my opponent had voted for allowing the up to 80 condos or apartments at Vickers. And I'm not right now passing judgment on that, but instead specifically pointing out the issue that many residents aren't aware because there's just so much complexity to how things are displayed. I'd love to see, really, for all different votes, making it easier in both newspapers and online to really address every single vote that's been, and just very clearly, simply, and quickly just showing this was the issue, this was how they voted. Same thing with the budget. It takes a long time to read through the budget. I think we really should be providing easier ways to do that, and residents should not be punished.
You're out of time.
Excellent, thank you.
Okay. Next is Mr. Gray.
I would like to take my time to talk about the Roswell City Walk. I am uniquely ingrained in Roswell City Walk, and one of my very best friends actually lives there. And we've met several people that live in the community. It's very nice. I think it's, you know, it's done what the intent was. It has absolutely fulfilled that. There's a problem, though. If this is allowed to move into other parts, the results not necessarily going to be the exact same. The Roswell City Walk is just that. It is a walk to the city. It's very close. Everybody wants to know when the old Southern Skillet is going to be redeveloped, and hopefully that will happen extremely soon, and that's one of the benefits. But they have the allure of Canton Street, and it's very, very close. If we're talking about redeveloping older apartments, it's a very slippery slope, because at that point, I don't think that it's going to make feasible sense for a developer to go in.
You're out of time.
Sorry.
Thank you. Next question.
Well, to continue on in that vein, I wanted to say earlier, if we're going to create space for people who live on modest incomes, that would be teachers, firefighters, police officers, and so on, it's going to have to be in areas that are already zoned for high density, such as our commercial corridors. And so it's redevelopment that we need to focus on, and putting our high density, mixed use complexes in and around those commercial corridors. That would be Highway 9, that would be also along Holcomb Bridge. I have another 58 seconds. Just as I wanted to say, is that it's redeveloping existing blighted properties or half empty or 20% occupied shopping centers. That's where we're going to get the land. That's where we're going to be able to redevelop it into a mixed use type of complex that could actually end up being our walkable community.
Thank you. And again, apologies for the timing. Mr. Spencer.
I have no comment.
Okay, thank you very much. Mr. DiPolito.
I also would like to reiterate a little bit about Roswell City Walk. And as I was going on, I realized I didn't talk about the fact, I started off saying that this is a unique project, and it's unique because it was a redevelopment. And I think we need to be real cautious as we're looking at other opportunities that we're looking at redevelopment. So when we're talking about apartments, we're not talking about a project like that being able to go anywhere. And I think some other folks here at the table have talked about that as well. The ideal situation is exactly what we did there, which is to take an existing apartment complex and to redevelop it and make it something better and make it more livable. A lot of the apartment complexes we have now are getting very old, and quite frankly, they're not as nice as they used to be, and it's time for them to be upgraded and to get nicer. So I think there's an opportunity there for us. It certainly would have a positive impact on the community and a positive impact on our schools.
Thank you. Mr. Porter, you're next.
Thank you. I just kind of follow up on what I was saying. You know, one of the other unintended consequences of these types of incentives that we have that get allowed is, when you think about it, it's a small percentage that each of us individually we pay. Maybe it's like 50, 60 bucks, something along those lines. So think about what you do if you had an extra 50, 60, 70 bucks in your pocket. Probably go out to dinner at one of the local restaurants. Maybe go get a massage at one of the local massage places. Maybe you're gonna go get your nails done. Maybe you're gonna go buy a video game from a local video store. My point is when you only have an extra 50, 60 bucks, you're gonna spend it at a local business more than likely. So what we're doing is we're taking this money, we're giving it to a company like GM, it's rich, doesn't need our money, they can afford to do this on their own, and we're saying it's to bring business to the area, but the reality is how much of that money actually stays here, and really what we're doing is we're taking money out of all the citizens' pockets, and we're preventing them from actually spending it back in the local economy. Thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Wynn.
Thank you. I was not going to do this, and then I had two, and one was MARTA and one was citizen involvement, and I'm going to go with citizen involvement. When I started council 8 years ago, we did not have the citizen involvement. We did not have the department heads and the staff that was necessary to do that. That has turned around. It's like turning around a battleship. It takes a while. But I think we've done a great job. When Councilmember DePolito and I came on board, we noticed that we needed to have more transparency on what our department heads were thinking, and we came up and created the community meetings that we have. I mean, our committee meetings that we have twice a month that are announced, are advertised, and yesterday we had some, and we had residents there speaking on an agenda item. I think we're very transparent. If anybody wants to know about how I voted, get online and listen to the minutes, because it's all video recorded and it's all audio recorded. But I think that we do a great job of our transparency to our citizens.
Thank you very much. Okay. Thank you for that. We are now moving on to round two, switching up the order just a little bit. Question one for round two goes to Mr. Horton. Topic is cycling. Topic is cycling. Roswell is considered a bike-friendly city. However, you rarely see women, children, or families riding outside their neighborhood or outside of a park. Bike lanes and shared lanes, sometimes known as sharrows, work for the risk-averse riders who are generally adult males, as research suggests. Mixed-use paths connect places and neighborhoods are very much more an effective way to encourage cycling for all members of society. Here's the question. How would you make Roswell a more bike-friendly, probably should say place, how would you make Roswell a more bike-friendly place for our less confident and vulnerable cyclists? Please provide details.
That's very difficult because you've got a couple of things that are really hampering the possibility of increasing that opportunity. The traffic in and around Roswell is almost impossible. And until we really address the traffic and the infrastructure regarding traffic, I'm not sure that we can make it more bike friendly for the less daring individuals that want to go out and bike. So in terms of biking for those individuals, I think what we need to do is make sure that our parks and recreation have opportunities for those people so that they don't have to go on those main roads where the traffic is much more dangerous.
Thank you. Second question goes to Mr. DePolito. Topic is apartments, multifamily dwellings. Under the UDC, multifamily and apartments are not approved by right for new developments in the city. The code requires conditional use approval for any multifamily or apartment development. Here's the question, it's a long one, I'll repeat it if needed. Balancing the desire to be a homeowner community with the need to provide workforce housing for those residents who fall on the lower end of the pay scale, is this a sustainable requirement to have in the UDC, or should there be areas designated where apartments are allowed by right? Why or why not?
Can I ask a clarification? When you're referring to what is in the UDC, what specifically are you referencing? You said, is it sustainable?
Reading the question here. Under the UDC, multifamily and apartments are not approved by right for new developments in the city. The code requires conditional use approval for any multifamily or apartment development.
So the question is, I'm sorry.
It's okay. Balancing the desire for a homeowner community where the need to provide workforce housing for those residents who fall on the lower end of the pay scale, Is this a sustainable requirement to have in the UDC, referring to the code that requires conditional use approval for any multifamily or apartment development?
Okay, thank you. Well, I think it's actually critical to have a conditional requirement for apartments in the UDC, and that was something that I absolutely insisted that we have, and I know a lot of my colleagues did as well, but I was not going to waver on that. We absolutely had to have a conditional use. Now, I know that we're having a lot of discussions, and there's been a lot of work done as far as workforce housing, and that's very critical. It's something that we need to have. But as I was talking about earlier, what we really need to focus on is our existing apartment complexes. We have quite a number of them. And really the opportunity there is to redevelop those and to take those and move them into a condition where they're much more livable and where they serve a variety of income levels. One of the things that the Roswell Housing Authority, one of their primary goals right now is to create mixed income communities. And that's what really makes a community successful, is to have people of various means living in the same area. So I think we have opportunities where we can have mixed income communities and put those in the right places. But yeah, absolutely, from a conditional use standpoint, I think we need to have that because we need to control it. And that is, in an earlier stage of Roswell's life, we didn't control it, and we are now reaping the problems that that caused. But now we have an opportunity to fix a lot of them.
Thank you. Next question goes to Mr. Gray. Topic is economic development. Roswell's neighbors in North Fulton County have been more coordinated and aggressive at supporting and attracting new development, particularly office development. Their marketing and outreach efforts have resulted in a more business-friendly reputation within the development and investment community. Given the size and scale of North Fulton County, portability is high for investors and business owners. The disparity in approach places Roswell at a disadvantage in retaining, growing, and attracting businesses. Here's the question. Specifically, how can Roswell improve its reputation and become more attractive to the business community?
I go back to 1999 with this answer. Like I told you before, I started my career at Polk Chevrolet in Roswell, Georgia. Jim Polk, who owned the dealership, moved out of Roswell down to Mansell Road, not for location, but because he wanted to get out of Roswell. He looked at the business environment. He looked at, and you think about it, that's where at that time, we were the very first dealership to move off of Alpharetta Highway and move on to Mansell Road. We have to look at ourselves and challenge ourselves to say, what kind of incentives can we bring? Nate was referring to the General Motors incentive, and with the economic development plan, yes, it's 4 years old. This is absolutely going in the right direction. Let me tell you why. We did not bring people from Detroit to Roswell. We took and we brought Roswell people to Roswell. Our next door neighbor, my and my wife's next door neighbor, works for General Motors. She did not work for General Motors until that development came to pass. This is a smart plan. We need to continue with it. We need to continue giving incentives. It does have ramifications for everybody involved, all taxpayers involved. We do participate, but the economic impact is absolutely far outweighed by what we give up in tax incentives. Thank you.
Okay. Question 4 to Ms. Howell. Topic, Comprehensive Plan 2035. The city is embarking on the Comprehensive Plan 2035 process that will continue through the spring of next year. Here's the question. Demonstrate your understanding of the comprehensive planning process. And what single concern do you most want to see addressed in the 2035 comprehensive plan?
So the 2030 comprehensive plan is a plan for the future for Roswell. It outlines things regarding economics, natural and cultural resources, and the framework for evaluating our development. What was the last thing you said?
You're on excuse me. And what single concern do you most want to see addressed in the 2035 comp plan?
So I think as far as developing, I would think housing. So I've been talking recently to elderly people, and I'll just start with 55 plus, right? Their concerns, and I heard it mentioned before, I know, right? Don't laugh. I'll start with the 55 plus because I've seen the housing in Alpharetta, and I've talked to several people that said the same exact thing that I've heard. Hey, I think it was Miss Beal that I talked to. I spoke with her. She's actually a person that doesn't get out. She votes absentee voting. And she said, you know, we need a plan that I can move out of this house, still be near my son, and I'm able to get somewhere where I can get into an apartment, and I don't have to deal with anyone as far as coming in, nursing, that kind of thing. I can do it on my own. So I think what I want that plan to deal with is something for 55 plus. That would be my main concern for the comprehensive plan.
Thank you very much. Question five to Ms. Nguyen. Topic is office space, not the movie. As Roswell's office market improves, the SEDP predicts a need for increased Class A office space, with large developments near Holcomb Bridge Road, the 400 corridor, and small developments south of Holcomb Bridge Road along State Road 9. Here's the question. In your mind, where do we most need Class A office space, and what involvement should the city have in attracting that type of development?
I think where it needs to go is really at our northwest, north-south quadrants at 400. That is a true area ready to be developed. It would be a true development. And I think we need to work on, which I am working on, getting a workable master plan for that area, especially those key properties. And it's just prime for revitalization and redevelopment. And I think that that's what we would do is add the opportunity zone as incentives, because Roswell is like only one of several cities that we have the opportunity zone at our fingertips for one of our tax incentives. The other place I think that we could do some office space is down, I would like to see some of the car dealerships maybe be some type of office space. I think Highway 9, driving through Highway 9, I feel like, I'm sorry if anybody's from Buford, but I feel like I'm driving through Buford Highway. And I think that we could use some Class A office space in those areas, but I would rather focus right now, I think, on the northwest, southwest quadrants, and would like to have that master plan also have the transportation needs that will carry that type of traffic. It should be part of it.
Thank you. Next question is to Mr. Palermo. Topic is transportation. Roswell has a number of high priority transportation projects that solve different issues and that are in different stages of design, funding, and prioritization. I'll read the list, and not in any particular order, which pertains to the question. Sun Valley Connector to Highway 9, Historic Gateway, Big Creek Parkway, Bridge over the Chattahoochee east of 400, hypothetical project, and Holcomb Bridge 400 interchange improvement. Here's the question. How would you prioritize these transportation projects? Explain your order, and please use the slide if you need to.
Thank you. So as we can see by this slide, there's definitely a lot of opportunity for improvement with our transportation challenges. And I think when really looking at solutions, I think at all times we have to really weigh in both the impact and really the I would call the amount of improvement in addition to really the cost. So with that, I think that's an important part of how I would look at this and look at how we need to rank it. You know, on one side, what I'm seeing in so much frustration from so many so many residents is specifically, of course, around the quadrants where Holcomb Bridge meets 400. Although I live here in West Roswell, I have so much support in East Roswell, and really have heard so much of the challenges all over, specifically trying to really get to 400, et cetera. So I think that's really a project I'd be looking at as a very, very high priority. But again, I think this is an example where these are all high cost, except for the Sun Valley Connector. And this is an example when looking at really how we pay for this. I know there is some stuff, as the mayor alluded to, really set up from the budget, but I think there are a lot of situations where we are gonna need bonds. And with that, what I love, again, I'm trying to really make it so that the residents are controlling what happens to our town, and bonds are a great way to give that control, because when we have that bond referendum, it gives them the vote. Thank you.
Thank you. Next question to Mr. Porter. Topic is Riverwalk Village. Riverwalk Village is a potential boon for the city with over $1 billion in development, but there are legitimate concerns over traffic and impact to the surrounding areas. Here's the question. What specifically would you want to see the developers change about this project to make the rezoning request more palatable? Why do you feel this would improve the project?
The first thing that I'd probably do is I'd want to make sure the traffic around that area was addressed first. I think that is more the city's responsibility to deal with as opposed to their responsibility. I know their responsibility is to increase it from, I believe it's an F to an E, or go one step from whatever the rating is. But when it's at the bottom, there's really not much, there's not much improvement that can be done. And then that improvement, once you get a bunch of houses that's been proposed, and you get all the extra people, the 70,000 extra cars that are gonna be on the road, if you haven't addressed that first, then you're gonna have, it's just gonna make the problem even worse. It's gonna be even more compound. The other thing that I think that needs to be changed with it is its monstrosity. It's like this huge project on steroids, and it needs to be scaled back to something that's actually reasonable and suitable for that specific area. I can't remember the total unit. I want to say it's like 1,100 apartment complexes altogether. That needs to be scaled back considerably. The other, I guess, just warning I want to throw out there too, and why I'm really hesitant to this project, is Avalon, even though Avalon's kind of a little bit of a success right now, it's set vacant for 4 years, 5 years, 3 years, I don't know the exact timeline. There's no reason that the same thing can't happen to this as well, to where it gets partially constructed, and then we're left with an even worse situation. We displaced a bunch of people, shut down a school in the process, so overall, there's a lot of issues with it.
Thank you. Last question of this round, and then we will go into candidate's choice for this round, to Mr. Spencer. Topic is town urbanist. Town urbanist. A town urbanist is an expert in urban design who would recommend best practices in connectivity and architectural massing, while also understanding the balance between growth, marketability, and a desire to build a better community. Within our current system and structure, this is a very challenging proposition. It sometimes seems that common sense urban design is thwarted by the political and planning processes. Here's the question. It's a long one, so I can reread it, or if you want to look at the slide as reference, please do so. Here's the question. Would you support a position such as the town urbanist within the city that would coordinate the competing interests of internal constituents, community development, historic preservation, transportation, and fire and police, to name a few, to ensure that the urban design best practices are represented and followed? Please elaborate on your rationale.
Whoever came up with this question is a genius, because this is something that I would endorse. It's been long needed. We need somebody to come into the city of Roswell that can coordinate all this with an open mind, get the processes sped up as it relates to doing business with the city of Roswell. But the politics is still gonna play a part in that. We all know that's gonna happen, but I would definitely support this person. They'd have to have an extensive background, and they probably wanna make a lot of money, but if they could come into the city of Roswell and coordinate all this under one roof with everybody and make things great here and make Roswell a more business-friendly community, I endorse that 100%. So, yes, it's a great question, and God bless the person that comes up with that question. I love it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Spencer. Okay, we're now staying within round two, but going back to the candidate's choice, we will start with Mr. Horton.
Rich mentioned earlier the issue of workforce housing, and that is a critical issue for Roswell from an economic standpoint as well as other reasons. First of all, most of the people who work in Roswell can't afford to live in Roswell. So that means at the end of the day, they're commuting to some other community outside of Roswell. When they come back to Roswell, they're creating traffic problems. When they commute back to their home, they're spending their money in that other community. Maybe they buy a home in that other community and pay their taxes in that other community. So we're missing out from an economic standpoint because we are not providing sufficient workforce housing here in Roswell. And so again, I'll go back to the one thing, if we're going to have affordable workforce housing, it's going to have to be in the commercial corridors where density is already allowed, and we just have to make changes to the code to allow for the kind of mixed-use housing that we need to have for these people.
Thank you very much. Rich, before I get, Mr. DiPolito, before I get to you, are we okay on the time? Okay, thank you. Mr. DiPolito?
Thank you. I'd like to address the question about cycling, because this is something that I have a real passion for. And not cycling necessarily by itself, but alternative means of transportation. One of the initiatives that I've been pushing forward most recently is to find a way to have multi-use trails and paths around the city that supplement all of our sidewalks. Right now it is difficult to cycle around the city unless you're a road warrior, and we have plenty of those, and I appreciate and respect them, but you're not going to see me challenging cars out on the roadway. But I think it's really important for our city to have alternative means to get around. It's recreational, but it's also for people to get to the grocery store, to get to work. And it could be by bike, could be by walking. I've been working closely with a landscape architect who lives in Roswell, who his company has volunteered time to look at ways to connect our creeks and put trails along our streams and creeks and create this additional network throughout the city.
Mr. DiPolito, you're out of time. I'm sorry.
Thank you.
Going to next question or rebuttal is Mr. Ray.
I wanted to speak to the office space comment. One of the people on the panel here mentioned that they wanted to talk about taking car dealerships and turning old car dealerships into office space. I got a problem with that. I'm in the car business. That hurts me. Especially when we move that dealership outside of Roswell. Going back to my original comment, if the current plan were in place in 1999, Jim Pope would have never moved his dealership outside of Roswell, just down the street to Alpharetta Highway, would have stayed in Roswell. Back up just a little bit. Understand that car dealerships provide, in most cases, 30% of the net revenue for the city. That's where all of that tax goes into our coffers. So please keep in mind that I don't believe that's the right thing. We need to redevelop old office spaces old business centers such as the old Ridgeway, the old Publix. That's where the office space needs to be.
Thank you. Ms. Howell?
All right, so the last time I spoke with you, it was about the 2030 plan. And I want to go back to that. I talked about Ms. Beal because I physically touched her, and her concerns really touched me. But there are two other things that I want to make sure that we focus on. The number one is the preserving of existing trees when people are building. That's truly important. It was the reason why I moved here. Trees, environment, animals. I mean, we need to focus on that. The second thing is about the lack of connectivity and the congestion problem, specifically Oakland Bridge, because it's our only exit. And that covers it.
Okay, thank you. Wynn, it's your turn now.
Well, I have to apologize to Shane over here because I broke his heart, and I can't break his heart because he's trying to make a baby, so I don't want to break his heart. But my husband was also in the car dealership, and he used to do auctions. And what I meant by used car dealers are the ones that's popping up at the old banks, Taco Bell's, Taco Mac, whatever. Those are the ones on South Atlanta Street that I was talking about. I'm not talking about our really great dealers of Carl Black and our Audi dealers and our BMWs. Those people are what we want to keep in Roswell. Those are the people that they are truly Roswellians. They want to be here. Carl Black hires veterans. So I do apologize to Mr. Shane Gray on that one. What I didn't mean was the ones that everybody goes, oh my God, they're an eyesore, can't you get rid of them? And we did by getting the new school, at least we got rid of one. So my thorough apologies for that one.
Thank you very much. Mr. Palermo.
Thank you. And so I actually want to go back to my my transportation question, and I can't see it in my notes here, but either way, what I wanted to address is one thing, and this is something I want to see more out of city or government as well. I'm not a fan of having, you know, just a list and prioritizing up here without having data in front of all of us, because I'm going to say something that I think most of the audience already knows. None of us up here are much smarter than anybody else here, and I think for any decisions that are being made for the city, it should be with all amounts of data, of historical information with traffic studies, as well as projected changes where we do have a lot going on of redevelopment, et cetera. And I want to just make sure that really when the city's making any decisions, it's having all the data right in front of them, and they're not having any bias or anything like that. So I just wanted to address the question I resorted to earlier.
Thank you. Going to Mr. Porter.
First, I just want to clarify from what Shane had said. If I implied that every single new job from GM came from somewhere else, that was not my implication. It was just that not all of the jobs were actually new jobs. Some of them transferred in. So that, just to clarify that. But I want to talk about the bicycle lane, because I know that a lot of people talk about connectivity and having this, you know, loop that's going to go all around the city. And then people using that to go to work and commute to work. And I think that's a good idea, and I think that it sounds like it's something that could potentially happen, but when I think about it in the terms of reality, I'm 4 miles away from my office. There's no way I'm biking in the middle of summertime. I'll be drenching wet by the time I actually get there. And I'm probably not going to do it much in the wintertime, because the downpour is quite frequently in the wintertime around here, at least it has since I've moved here. So I don't see myself really biking a whole lot outside of the occasional odd spring day where it's really, really nice. So while I like the idea of it, as far as an actual solution to our transportation needs, it's like the most impactful thing I've ever heard of.
Thank you. Mr. Spencer.
I would like to address the question about traffic that Mr. Palermo discussed. I believe it was him. Traffic in Roswell is not caused by the people that are in this room. Our traffic is caused by people from Cobb, Cherokee, Alpharetta, Sandy Springs, all around us. And it's because we're at the hub of North Fulton County. There's four ways to get across the river. There's Johnson's Ferry Road. It's a mess. We have three of them in Roswell. Highway 9, Georgia 400, and Holcomb Bridge Road. We need another bridge across the river. We don't need it, but somebody else needs to take that responsibility. I believe that we shouldn't penalize the people and the businesses in Roswell because the traffic that we got is so terrible. I don't like it. I live on Upper Henry Road. Sometimes I have to wait to get in and out of my driveway in the morning and afternoon. I don't like that one bit.
Mr. Spencer,
thank you.
Okay, well, that concludes round two. We will now move into round three, again, a different order of questions and answers, and then candidate's choice, and then closing. Round three, question one goes to Mr. Horton. Topic is historic preservation. To be considered historic, a property must have three essential attributes. sufficient age, a relatively high degree of physical integrity, and historical significance. Our historical district is defined by exemplar buildings with architectural character that meets these criteria, but others do not. Here's the question. How will you protect the character of the historic district while also understanding the desire of property owners to capitalize on investments they have made in their property in what is a highly desirable area of our city for both businesses and residents?
Well, first of all, I think it's important to understand that any kind of development within the historic district needs to have the flavor of the historic district. And we leave that partly to the Historical Preservation Commission, but also I think we should have input from the Historical Society. I just feel that anybody that wants to develop in that area really needs to understand our history and exactly how whatever it is they plan to develop will fit in with the overall character of the community. Our historic district, one of the reasons we moved here in 1986 is because we fell in love with the history of Roswell and the quaint little community. And I remember on Sunday mornings we used to go down Campus Street to get to church, and we'd see Mr. Funderburk out on the road right in front of the grocery store, and he would be selling his vegetables from the back of his truck. That's our history. There is more of our history here. And I just think we need to pay a lot more attention to it. I think we need to have any developer that plans to do any work within the historic district has to meet certain criteria, and they have to be willing to understand the character and build according to the character in the district.
Thank you. Ms. Nguyen, this is your question. Topic is Unified Development Code, also known as the UDC. Zoning codes are living, breathing documents that go through iterations and evolve over time. There have been many criticisms of the UDC, just as there were many criticisms of the prior zoning codes. Here's the question. Understanding that a zoning code is neither the cause nor the solution to all of our issues, what chapter of the UDC do you feel needs to be reviewed and edited most, and why?
I think we just had a case come to us a couple of weeks ago that was on South Atlanta Street, and it was a multi-use, mixed use for retail and then 14 rentals above. And even though I thought that was a great idea, it was a catalyst that we needed down at South Atlanta Street, it was denied. So I think one chapter that we do need to look at is how do we want our mixed use really to be mixed use? And should we be looking in our district saying 14 or 16 or 18 rentals on top of retail are fine or not? I mean, it's going to be one of those, I think, very long topics that we're going to have long discussions. But I think that we need our staff to have the clarity of what exactly the mayor and council wants in mixed use where it comes to residential versus non-residential. And that's the chapter I would like to look at.
Thank you. Next question goes to Mr. Spencer. Topic is economic development. Entrepreneur magazine recently named Alpharetta the top small city in America to start a small business. Alpharetta also received the honor of being the best city for female entrepreneurs in the country. Here's the question. Should Roswell have a more vibrant entrepreneurial culture? If not, why? If so, what will you do specifically to support it?
Well, first off, Entrepreneurial Magazine's got it wrong. I think that even though with all the stuff that's going on in Alpharetta, I think we have that spirit, the people here, like Nate, that endorse this. And for us to endorse that here also, we have to do things that we normally wouldn't do to make this happen. I'm not an entrepreneur. I work for city government my entire life. And I don't really know much to say about that other than, yes, I agree with it that we need to endorse it. Yes, I agree with it that it needs to be here and it doesn't need to be in Alpharetta. I love Alpharetta, but I love Roswell more. So let's just make it happen. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, question four goes to Mr. Porter. Topic is redevelopment. There have been a number of suggestions that redevelopment should be targeted towards areas that are dead or aging. Lingering examples include the Southern Skillet Shopping Center and Roswell Village Shopping Center. Recent successes are City Walk, Elementary Schools, Connection Shopping Center, to name a few. Many of these properties are within the Opportunity Zone here in Roswell. Here's the question. Do you believe the city has a role in directing redevelopment, or is that a function of the market? If the city does not have a role, why? If it does, what strategy or strategies do you support to effectively accomplish this?
The first business that I opened up, real business, was in Grand Rapids, Michigan. It was in essentially what used to be an old garage. It looked like an oil workshop. I painted it up, put a desk in there, not the nicest of desks, but it was a blighted area, very much so, but it was a blighted area that I could afford to operate business out of. So even though some of these blighted areas might not necessarily be the best as far as visually speaking, these are things that are necessary for entrepreneurs. If you want to talk about creating an entrepreneurial spirit here in the area, one of the ways is to allow entrepreneurs to have different price ranges so that they can actually operate their businesses, so that they can actually address whatever their personal business needs are. As far as the city's role, and the city's role is to get out of the way. These economic development zones that they have, where if I were to have moved my business to a very specific area to incentivize it, again, that's just money that's taken out of all of our pockets, that's essentially given to a landlord so that they can have a business in a very specific area. If that money, again, would have been allowed for me to keep in my business, if it's allowed for you guys to keep and spend the way that you guys want to, that's how we're going to get real economic growth. That's how we're going to have the entrepreneurial spirit. Sorry to answer both questions in that, but that's essentially it.
Thank you. Mr. DiPolito, the next question is yours. Topic is downtowns. This is a lengthy preamble getting to a question, so if you'd like to use the slide as reference, please do so. My apologies in advance. Downtowns. Virtually every neighboring city to Roswell has recently embarked on or plans to begin significant investments in their downtowns. Downtown Woodstock at for $11 million bond, Alpharetta City Center for $20 million bond, $29 million bond, the district in Johns Creek TBD investment, Sandy Springs City Center at $84 million, Milton with a $10 million bond. To date, the city of Roswell has invested very little in the heart of the city in comparison to our neighbors. The DDA has identified the City Green Project as the most effective use of development dollars. Total cost of the project is estimated to be $17 million, I'm rounding. And the city is proposing a bond referendum that will also include dollars for the new fire station and apparatus, intersection improvements, road construction, reconstruction funds, Oxbow realignment and sidewalk connectivity. Total amount would be $33 million. Here's the question. Do you support the City Green Project? Why or why not? If so, do you support using this bond referendum to fund the project?
Thank you. Yes, I do support the City Green Project, but let me correct a few things. The city is not proposing a bond referendum. There have been some early discussions about it, but there actually is not a proposal. The other correction would be that the City Green does not cost $16.74 million. There are two pieces to the overall project, which is there's a transportation element, and then there's the City Green itself. The transportation piece is about half of that. I believe the mayor mentioned earlier that the current phase that we're talking about, which is the bulk of the City Green itself, is about $5 to $6 million. But I think that what's important about the City Green is that it creates a sense of place. And right now we don't have that sense of place behind the City Hall. We have a nice place, but it doesn't create an environment that is cohesive to the rest of the downtown area. Right now you walk down Canvas Street and all of a sudden you have a gas station and you have some old buildings, and on the other side of the street you have a forest, which is a beautiful forest, but when you're trying to build a village feel and have the continuity of Canton Street, something has to happen on the other side of the street. And what the City Green does is it creates an active environment, it creates a place for people to go. It really becomes a good, solid downtown area for our residents, for tourists to come, for people to come out and enjoy. And it's an extension of Camp Street. They'll extend it beyond City Hall and down toward the river.
Thank you. Next question is to Mr. Gray. Topic is crime. There's a significant crime issue in the area to the northwest of the Holcomb Bridge and 400 interchange. There have been several murders and violent crimes in this area in the past 2 years. Here's the question. What solutions can you offer to address this issue, and how will you commit to resolving it in your term on council?
It's pretty simple. I believe we subsidize police officers to live in the communities. Whenever you have a police officer who lives in the community, they protect the community. I can guarantee you, you don't see break-ins next to a cop's house. I know, because I lived next to a cop for 4 years. So it's that basic. I don't need a minute nine to go over the fact that if we just give them a little bit more incentive, a little bit more of a stipend, pay a little bit of their mortgage every month, or a little bit more of their rent, the crime is taken care of itself. I'm done.
Okay, thank you. Next question goes to Mr. Palermo. Topic is historic preservation. In 2013, the city accepted a master plan for our historic district from a world-renowned planning firm, DPZ. The critical point is that the master plan was not adopted and thus did not have any teeth and has become yet another reference document in the city's archive. Here's the question. Do you feel that a guiding master plan for our historic district is important? And would you support something similar in concept to Blueprint Midtown that would act as an official guide for what future development should look like in the historic district?
So I feel, just want to make sure I'm answering the question properly, I feel that a guiding master plan for the historic district could be very valuable as long as it's created in an appropriate manner that really is going to protect our history, protect our character, and I feel it should have teeth to ensure that really what makes Roswell so special and so unique is continued to be protected. Because with that, I'm sure a lot of you already know that I'm very passionate about protecting our history, the fact that I truly do believe it adds so much to our character and adds so much to our housing values. And so I'm sure a lot of you may have already seen on social media, I have a video. And that video is specifically illustrating how the code that my opponent had approved actually changed the zoning with the Dolvin House right next to Bullock Hall. And so with this, if you go online and look at it, if you haven't seen it, it actually illustrates exactly how you could now build 5 houses on top, pretty much on top of it, right next to Bullock Hall. And I'd be very curious to hear from my opponent if that was an oversight in the code and really just something that was missed, or if instead it's just that with it there's not that care to really protect what makes Roswell, what I consider many residents making Roswell so special.
Thank you. Okay. The last question of this round before we get to the candidate's choice is to Ms. Howell. Topic is 2016 budget. 2016 budget for Roswell is roughly $119 million. The largest component is the general fund at $68 million, which is about 57% of the total budget, and then the capital fund improvement fund at $11 million, which is roughly 9%. Here's the question. What areas of the budget do you feel need to be changed, i.e. eliminated, reduced, or expanded, and why?
So I have a copy of the budget in front of me, specifically for the general fund proposals, and I had questions on, you know, the cost of the signature festival, that's $100,000, or I think there was another one, Roswell's Inc.'s $25,000. So what I would do would would be to roll through the whole budget and identify where efficiencies could possibly be made. That's what I would do. Go through line by line and figure out where we could move money or cut money and see how we can better do this.
Thank you. Okay. We are now staying within round three, but going to Canada's choice, going back through the order that we just started with. Mr. Don Porter.
Let's take a look at the budget just for a second. I'm a proponent of what we call zero-based budgeting. In other words, every year or every 6 months, you have to have a rolling process. But you start with every department with zero, and you justify each of the expenses through the entire budget. So the department heads would have to do that. They'd have to work with their people. And when you have zero-based budgeting, you end up saving a considerable amount of money. It's more complex. It takes more time. But zero-based budgeting is really the direction we're going to go if we're going to have an efficient budget.
Thank you. Ms. Wynn?
Thank you. I was not going to address this, what my opponent said, because, but I am. The UDC for the Historic Preservation Commission was submitted to and adopted by the Mayor Council, but it was submitted to by the Preservation Commission, who rules or governs over the historic preservation areas. So to say that I'm the one that did it, it takes a majority of people to get something passed, and I think it was almost unanimous. 5 out of 6 people voted for the UDC. So if 5 out of 6 people vote for it, and the mayor who can't vote is all for it, I don't see anything bad about it. And I'm just glad that we have the Historic Preservation Commission, because I think that they do a great job governing our historic district and trying to keep it as historic as possible under state law. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Spencer.
Can I speak on the parking deck?
Yes, you may. This is your opportunity to speak.
Or parking on Kent Street. I know we've looked, they've looked to where we can put cars for people to come on Kent Street. But have we looked at building a parking garage or parking deck on City Hall property on the lower levels of the parking area? They built a very nice parking deck in Alfred, and I hate to bring Alfred into the equation, but it seems like it's working very well. I know the cost is quite expensive to build parking decks, but if we're going to continue to endorse Canton Street and have people come here, they shouldn't have to walk a half mile to mile to get to the destination to spend the money that they're going to spend in this town. So maybe we should look at a public-private partnership on parking deck on City Hall grounds. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Porter.
I want to address a question with regards to the budget and what I would cut out of the budget. If you look at this is from the budget, the $119 million, 14% of that goes to parks and recreation, 11% of it goes to actual transportation projects. We spent $16.6 million on our 900 acres. When you take into consideration that there's 42 almost square miles of Roswell land, that 900 acres is 3% of the square area. We're spending 14% of the budget on this little bit of land. And everybody on this stage wants us to get more land and buy more areas to preserve. And I just think I think it's ridiculous. I'm not saying we shouldn't preserve land. I'm not saying we shouldn't have green space. What I'm saying is that we shouldn't be spending more on that than we do on transportation. That we shouldn't spend more on 3% than anything else.
Thank you. Mr. DiPolito?
Thank you. I'd like to speak a little bit about redevelopment. Mr. Porter mentioned that he thought putting in a trail system was impractical. Well, there's a little thing down in Atlanta called the Atlanta Beltline, which is exactly the type of thing that we're talking about. And that Beltline has created an enormous boon for the city of Atlanta, hundreds of millions of dollars of investment. So we talk about redevelopment, we really need to look at what ways can the city provide opportunities like that, either through a trail network, providing additional connections, but also providing for infrastructure. Another thing that we have done with the city of Roswell is we put in the midtown streetscape. We've seen huge investments in that. That's something that I pushed very hard for when I first got on council. So the city's role in redevelopment is to help with the infrastructure, provide these city projects that spurs redevelopment of existing properties and provides for economic development.
Thank you. Mr. Grant.
I too would like to talk about budget. When you get down to money, that's when my eyes light up. I will say this, I feel like I was just talking about the police and how we save our blighted communities. We take, right now, 25% of our budget goes to the police. That needs to be increased. The increase would help cover that stipend that they would get in order to live in these underserved communities. Also, when we take money away, when we raise something, we gotta take it away from somewhere. Community development. If we have better communities, if we have safer communities, that's your community development right there. You're also going to look at transportation. We need to increase our transportation budget, once again, taking away from community development. I feel that community development goes hand in hand with crime and with when you're putting the Transportation Act in there.
Mr. Palermo, thank you. Oh, excuse me, Mr. Gray, I apologize. Mr. Palermo is next.
Thank you. So as I discussed at the beginning, really transparency and raising more resident awareness is very important to me. So I ask you, please go to my Facebook page, my website, or go to YouTube and look at my Dolvin House video. It takes 90 seconds and it will show you, and I ask you to make a decision for yourself. Do you feel that this represents successful historic preservation? Because again, I want more resident awareness. I want people to really make decisions for themselves. And I don't feel it should be by having to look up and go online and see 2-hour videos or audio recordings of City Hall meetings to see specifically how all your representatives have been voting. That's why I would push so hard to make sure it's completely easy to understand right in front of your eyes to know exactly how I would vote for you, as well as all the city council would vote for you, and each thing's coming up. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Ms. Kay Howell.
So we talked a little bit about crime. I'm sure we've all touched on it. The one thought I had several discussions with people in the community, and they said that they needed more activities. And I was thinking we could probably impact crime by having the police be involved with the community. And I mean, as in kids, start early. So then you can develop that relationship over the years. So you won't get, I guess, teenagers or early 20s. If the police are in the neighborhood with them and they know them, and that's a good way so that we can stop. We won't be able to do anything about the crime now, except doing what we're doing. But as far as in the future, we can stop crime if they have a relationship with the police.
Thank you. This is the last section of our debate for our forum this evening, and it is closing remarks. Again, the order has been changed. We will start with Mr. Shane Gray.
Thank you. I just wanted to say that it's been an unbelievable ride these past 2.5-3 months that I've declared my candidacy. It's amazing. There's a lot of work still to be done. I love Roswell. Like I've said before, Roswell's a part of my DNA. Roswell, when I look at what needs to be addressed, we have tremendous traffic issues. It's the number one reason why I'm running. We have amazing density issues. That's the number one reason why I'm running, because they actually go hand in glove together. We have to slow down on our development, not developing. We need to redevelop. We need to look at blighted areas. We need to look at the old Ridgeway. We need to look at the old Publix. We need to do what we need to do in order to give the incentive to the owners to redevelop these properties. Moving into another section, Let's take a look at, and we have not mentioned, we talk about how great Alpharetta is. Who cares? I sure as hell don't. I'm going to be honest with you. I live in Roswell. Let me tell you what I'm talking about when I say Roswell. We have an unbelievable community here. We are not, and we're going to spend between $5 to $15 million, depending upon whoever you ask, when it comes to the city walk. Back up. City Green. Man, we got all these walks and greens, and they run together. And that's the problem. We got all of these things, and they just all run together. We have a town square that we haven't spoken about one time this evening. It's the most prized jewel that we have outside of the Chattahoochee. And it's like it doesn't exist. We need to develop. We need to spend, if we're going to spend $5 to $15 million, we don't know how much it's going to cost for the City Green, we need to be talking about spending that money, not that much, but reinvesting that in our square. And that is our crown jewel. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Ms. Becky Wynn.
Thank you, and I want to thank Roswell Nixon for y'all to showing up tonight. I think that Roswell has a unique opportunity to balance progress while maintaining our character. Cities succeed because of the vision and leadership of dedicated public servants. It is imperative that we have elected officials who understand the importance of establishing a solid foundation. As we approach the November 3rd election, I want to share with you a bit about what my colleagues and I have been doing to solidify that foundation. Through the recession and recovery, we've concentrated on careful balanced budgeting. As a result, we've been able to keep our services high and not have a mileage rate increase. And additionally, we've maintained our AAA bond rating. The city has developed tax incentives, formed an economic development organization, revised codes, and created a downtown development authority, which is helping to rehabilitate some of our old commercial buildings and strip centers. You know, I live here too. I'm a Roswellian, so quality of life to me is very, very, very important to me. That's why we're adding an adaptive sports field for our disabled citizens, and we have increased the resources for our park maintenance and for beautification of our parks. And because you supported our most recent bond referendum, we're adding a therapeutic pool for our seniors and citizens with disabilities, building our new fire chief, building our new fire station number 4, and completing our street improvements. I have been a neighborhood and community advocate for over 20 years. I've been in your shoes, and I know what it feels like to be in your shoes. And I understand that listening to you is the most critical part of being a city council person. And I humbly ask for your vote November 3rd, because I would be honored to continue to serve in you for another 4 years. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Palermo.
Thank you. I want to thank everybody again for coming tonight and really paying attention. This is such an important election, and I appreciate you giving it true thought. I'm going to stick with what I feel was my theme tonight, which was really wanting to increase the transparency from our city government, and specifically increase the fact that having more residents participate, and really the constant reminder that city council is here to serve you and to work for you. As some of you may be familiar, an example I want to call out is currently there's a proposal for rules of decorum where there's a lot been going on with your neighborhoods, and there's a lot of votes that truly will impact your life in Roswell, your family's life in Roswell, and it's important that city government is hearing exactly what you were thinking, what's on your mind. And currently with these rules of decorum, one of the things on there is if there's to be multiple people that appear to be discourteous, then there's the potential that actually the session could be shortened. This is under the number 7 enforcement part, which mentions not only could an individual be ejected, but specifically the time given could be shortened. Again, I want to remind you that if I am fortunate enough to earn your vote, I truly realize I work for you. You hired me. And it's my job to listen to what you have to say. It's my job to really go in the direction that you give me. So whether you choose to vote tomorrow or on Tuesday, I really do ask that you hire me and realize that I will take my really skill set that I've used in the corporate world to find a lot of success from my MBA at Emory, and really just the passion I have in making sure that my daughter and my family grow up in the best area possible. And that's what I will do every single day if I get to work for you, make sure that Roswell continues to be the best place possible. Thank you so much for your time today, and please do vote for me.
Thank you. Mr. Spencer, your closing remarks, please.
Thank you very much, and I want to appreciate everyone that came out tonight and sit and listen to everyone's views on what's going on in the city and what we can do for you. But being a resident of Roswell for 60 years, I've had a front row seat watching it grow from a small town to one of the largest cities in the state. I take great pride in my city. I have given everything I have to this city and continue to serve as your council member to help steer us in the right direction as it grows is my number one priority. There's not one of my opponents who knows this city up and close like personally like I do. I have qualifications that no other candidate for post three can compare, setting and managing a $6 million budget for the fire department, 10 years as a department head, managing 140 employees, attending approximately 250 council meetings, collaborating with all city and department heads for more than 10 years, and experience knowing which ones work with our process, which ones need to be improved upon. I am the best candidate because I am for Roswell and versus against Roswell. And do not fuel the fires of people who are disheartened by the way things are going in our city council and in our city. So in closing, I love the city of Roswell. I love the people that live here. I love working for the city of Roswell. I want to continue to work for the city, and I want to continue to work for you because I'm going to listen to what you have to say. I'm going to act on your behalf because that's what council members do. I'm going to serve you. I am here to help protect you, and I'm here for you as I always have been for the 60 years that I've lived in this community. Thank you very much, and on November 3rd, please vote for Ricky Spencer. You will be glad you did. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Mr. DiPolito, your closing remarks, please.
Thank you. First, I'd like to thank RoswellNEXT again for organizing the forum. They do such a great job getting out in the community and raising issues. These were super questions, and some of these were really hard. So I'm really glad they put this together, and I really appreciate it. You know, there have been a lot of priorities listed here across the table tonight. And I have to say, I agree with all of them. And that's the difficult thing about being on council, is how do you juggle all that? Transportation is critically important. That's been a number one priority for me since I've been on council before. Redevelopment is equally as important. But we have one of the best park systems in the country. We're always in the top four, top five, and I'm confident one of these days we're gonna win the gold medal. But it takes a lot to run a city. It's not just one thing or another. You can't put all your dollars in one place. You kind of have to spread it out. And that's why we have such wonderful culture, and we have such great great art events, and we have just wonderful historic properties, and we preserve our historic properties, because we're spreading the money around, and we're taking care of everything. And it's a juggling act. It's not easy. It's really difficult. But probably the most important thing is to get feedback from the community. And that's something that it hurts my heart, literally, when I hear people say that the city isn't listening to them. Because we try so hard to get out there, to push out information. I'll tell you something really interesting. When I was over the administration department, one of the things I said to our communications director is, we need to push information out to the community when we have things coming online. And she said, well, you know, historically we haven't done that. We've been very reactive. And I said, no, we're not reactive anymore. We need to be proactive. What's important for us, we're going to do our best to push information out to you, but we need to hear from you. So please get involved. And you are what makes Roswell great. Thank you for being here tonight. I appreciate your vote on November 3rd.
Thank you. Mr. Horton, your closing remarks, please.
Again, thanks to RoswellNEXT and everybody that came out tonight to hear about this important election. Roswell is a great place to live. Everybody here will agree to that.
But I feel that there are some on City Council who are just on the wrong track about the kind of city the people of Roswell want to live in. They changed their zoning codes, and in the process, they jeopardized the very things that give Roswell the appeal it has. If we don't do something about it now, it's going to be too late by the next election. We are already making profound changes. For example, if you look at the historic district, instead of 35% lot coverage in the old zoning code, it's now 70%. That's double what it was. Density was removed as a limitation in the code. So now we're going from one or two houses to an acre to five or six, and in some cases, 7 to 10. And we're doing this next to some of our established neighborhoods. And why do we need to do that? Let me be clear, we do need development, but our focus is wrong. We are neglecting blighted areas all over Roswell, and I say, let's redevelop them. Today, 88% of our workforce in Roswell can't afford to live in Roswell. In fact, many of us have kids that can't afford to live in Roswell. But the new developments that we're seeing are all about $400,000 cottages or $600,000 townhomes and higher. Instead, we should be looking at redevelopment that will create housing for young families and professionals who are the future of our city. But in order to do that, we're going to need a change on City Council. You have a lot of choices for post three, but I believe I'm the most qualified candidate to deal with these issues. And that's with my over 30 years of experience in business and over a decade of service to my community. I've worked with a number of groups, including the Roswell Initiative for Community Housing, so I know what some of the housing needs are. I've helped neighborhoods and developers come together and create good projects that have the support of the people. I know and understand zoning and development from both public and private sector point of view, and I want to bring business experience, not just government experience, into city operations. Most important, if you elect me, I will represent your interest on these issues. Thank you again.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Porter, your closing remarks, please.
I just want to thank everybody for coming out. I know these things get long, and I'm sure you guys are probably ready to go home at this point. I'm going to make it really simple for you guys. There's really one reason why you guys should vote for me. Whether you agree with what I have to say up here, or whether you disagree with what I have to say up here, I'd be the lone dissenting voice on the City Council. I'd be a different point of view. I'd be a different perspective. I wouldn't be an echo chamber. I wouldn't be, you know, everybody raising their hands and voting for the same thing. Not saying they always vote unanimously. But if you look and if you've listened to everything that you've heard from everybody else on stage, they're giving you the exact same brand of government, but just a different flavor. Some are, you know, Coke flavored, some are Dr. Pepper, but all of them have the same general concepts of believing that we just need to have the, you know, city government responsible for all of these different things. I'm different. One, I'm a millennial, I'm younger, so when you guys talk about bonds, all I can think about is what I'm going to have to pay for and what my kids are going to have to pay for, you know, 10, 15 years from now, so I'm not excited about that. But more importantly, again, I'll be the lone dissenting voice. I will bring up points of view, and one vote for me isn't necessarily going to change the course, but what it might do is it might cause City Council to think, you know what, hey, maybe we shouldn't pass this bond for kids' soccer field right now because we've got all of these different projects for transportation that are coming up. Maybe we should, instead of buying these 50 acres of land for $5 million, maybe instead of doing that, we got all these transportation projects that are coming up. Maybe we should do that instead. So again, the reason why you should vote for me as opposed to anybody else that's running for post three is I will at least bring a different point of view, whether you agree with it or not. It's something that's going to help change the whole conversation. It's going to help better Roswell as a whole, as opposed to one big sounding board, one big echo chamber. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Ms. Howell, your closing remarks, please.
I want to start off with thank you for coming. It is very long, so I will make it as quick as I can. Let me start off first with what Nate said about us all being the same. So voting for me would not be the same as everyone else, as you can see and clearly see with me sitting here. You can laugh on that. So after November 3rd, someone will be deciding our property tax rates, approving budgets, acting on zoning issues, and deciding many aspects that affect our lives. In fact, these choices and actions will affect our salaries, our housing, our employment, and our Roswell culture. You may know me as Kay Howell, aspiring candidate for the City Council, but even after hearing my thoughts, you still might not know or have any idea of who I am or why I'm running. In the beginning of my campaign, my cam- campaign manager asked, "Kay, why are you running?" So I gave him the pat answer, you know, things that I thought he wanted to hear. And he said, "No, Kay, why are you running?" "I'm running because I know I will act well on choices and actions that affect our homes, our families, and our communities. Now, you may not know me like that, but I encourage you to come talk to me before you make your decision on the 3rd, because I am the candidate, and you will see on my website that I am here to listen, to learn from you, and then lead with you. I'm asking for your vote today. Vote Kay Howell on November 3rd.
Thank you. That concludes tonight's forum. We hope what you've heard tonight will help you make an informed decision if you have not voted yet. If you have voted, hopefully you've heard and some opposing point of views or some supportive point of views. Please vote Tuesday. It's coming Tuesday, November 3rd. Shameless plug here for Roswell Next. They have completely revamped their website from a local Roswell resident and business owner, Sam Chantos, right there, developed the website. Please check it out. On behalf of Roswell Next, we'd like to thank our host, High Meadows School, the candidates, and of course, tonight's audience. Thank you. Good night.
No.